And all the tears are rolling down your face. And it feels like yours was the only heart to break. When you come back home and all the lights are out, and you're getting used to no one else being around.
Hello, everybody. Good evening, and welcome to SGInnovate. I'm glad that everybody's here, and thank you for being a part of this event tonight. I hope that by being here, you agree already with at least one of our basic philosophies as SGInnovate, which is artificial intelligence applied to healthcare is both critically important and inevitable, because there are so many different issues around an aging population, imperfectly allocated resources in terms of healthcare providers and caregivers. And so our basic philosophy is it's not whether there will be AI in healthcare as a long-term and more pervasive set of solutions, but in what way, and how do we think about the issues with data and ethics and responsibility or liability, trust. How do we think about these things? We as a team have made a number of investments into early stage companies that are focused on image detection in medical application. So we're naturally believers that this is a critically important area. And for those that don't know, SGInnovate seeks to be useful to deep tech startups, deep tech entrepreneurs. And part of what we do here with these types of discussions is bring people together on shared topics. This is a very important one. And we take advantage of the fact that there are times when people are in town that are not normally available to us to bring really important discussions to the table. And Kimberly Powell, VP of Healthcare for NVIDIA, is in town for the MTech conference that's currently underway today and tomorrow. So we're very thankful to have the opportunity with our good friends at NVIDIA to make possible the opportunity for Kimberly to be a part of what we're doing and to share her perspectives with you and ideally to take questions from you. So as always, I'll do what I always do and ask for us to have a conversation. It's not meant to be a big listen and then leave. It's meant to be an engagement. Kimberly will be sharing thoughts and perspectives, and then I'll have the opportunity to pose a few questions. Most importantly, I hope to simply do the job of taking your questions and posing them to Kimberly. I have a few of my own already, but please be engaged. So I don't want to delay it any further. I'm going to do what I always do for those that have been here before, and that is jump up, and we're going to take a picture so that we have this very amazing moment memorialized. So I'm going to ask Kimberly to join me here, and everybody please jump up. And if you don't feel comfortable smiling at the camera, then look away. Okay, so that will be out there for your memory moment on social media, and what we always like to do is reinforce the fact that Singapore has great capabilities. We just need to try and be more courageous in building some deep tech startups. So now into some very critical discussion topic, and Kimberly will introduce herself in whatever way is most amazing and impressive. So over to Kimberly Powell. Please join me in welcoming Kimberly.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you for having me. This is a really cool spot. It's my first time in Singapore. I have not had pepper crab yet. That's tonight, so I don't want to stay here too long. I'm really excited about pepper crab. I'm a foodie at heart. Had myself some stingray, some crayfish, some satay, but I'm really excited for the pepper crab. So just to briefly introduce myself, I've been at NVIDIA going on almost 11 years. And I started the healthcare practice at NVIDIA about 11 years ago. Is everyone familiar with the fact that we actually have a healthcare practice? Or is this new information? Okay, yeah, it's pretty cool, right? So what's interesting about the healthcare practice is we've been working on it and been on this journey for 11 years, and there's been a lot of transitions that are allowing us to see really, really interesting opportunities, probably a hope to express even above and beyond what you guys are experiencing, reading in the news, when you're seeing new companies. So I always like to just talk a little bit about NVIDIA's roots. Some of you, hopefully all of you, are gamers, understand our tech, a little bit about our roots. You know we came from gaming. We invented the GPU in 1999. We created this technology called programmable shaders, and it really unlocked all of the abilities of artists around the world to create photorealistic, completely photoreal images, virtual worlds. We took on, as we went and created a processor that was so amazing at that, we realized how much math we were doing. Okay, if you want hair to look like hair, there's a massive amount of math and physics in order to do that. That's when we invented the accelerated computing platform we call CUDA. That's when I joined the company. I joined when CUDA was just a baby, and it was really, really hard to sell to any developers. But there was a few radiologists at the Massachusetts General Hospital that said, if I could just do this math and this algorithm called iterative reconstruction, I could reduce the dosage by 80% of CT scans. That's a huge, huge accomplishment. You know that it has radiation. It's very unsafe for children. The number of children who get exposed to CT scans at that high of dose, they will develop cancer. This was a really important problem, and something that when NVIDIA gets essentially exposed to a problem of that important, importance and that magnitude, even if it's just for two radiologists, we're going to work on that problem. And so we use the CUDA platform to essentially achieve that iterative reconstruction, and in a computational footprint that was, like, you know, achievable. You could pay for it. You didn't need a whole server room next to the CT scanner. And it kind of just went from there. Now, what happened to us, as you know, in 2012 was, because we put this CUDA technology on every device we made, on the very low-end gaming card that you could buy at Fry's, or I don't know what the stores are here, the internet malls, we put that technology on everything. That was a huge investment, a huge risk on our part. But we knew that the gamers were going to want it, we knew that any designers were going to want it, and we knew that researchers and students could really unlock their scientific thinking. We could really unlock what was possible in their mind if they could get access to this technology. And so what happened in 2012 is the computer vision research community realized that these neural networks that were discovered many decades before were now becoming super viable, because we had data floating all around us with our phones, creating all of the pictures and video and the internet and YouTube and you name it. That deep learning, these neural networks, could be a very, very effective new way to do computer vision, and they achieved a massive jump, as you guys know. And so that was a very sort of opportunistic, that happened to us. There was a bit of destiny in that. But I was very active in developing that community. I was at the time also heading up our higher education business globally. So I was working with the researchers who were developing the frameworks that now constitute all of the tools that you use if you are developing deep learning. Now, just over the past 12 months, deep learning is fantastic, and it's awesome at things that I care deeply about and my roots come from, which is radiology and images, but there is a whole massive amount of healthcare information that we are generating that aren't images. And there are decades and decades of machine learning algorithms that are very useful for a lot of applications. And so just over the past 12 months, we've released an accelerated data science platform using all the open tools that many of you are probably familiar with, being able to use pandas and data frames and accelerating the data preparation and data science all the way through to all of the great machine learning algorithms like XGBoost or PCA or DBScan. And so what's cool about this story, and I like to tell it, is yes, I believe AI is important, but I also believe accelerated computing is important, especially to what we're going to see coming in healthcare. And so we've taken these three capabilities of the GPU, computer graphics, accelerated computing, and AI, and we're applying it to some very important industries. We chose to work on self-driving cars starting 8 years ago because we had this intuition to say, a self-driving car is going to be software-defined. If it's software-defined, it's probably going to need a different kind of computer than we've ever seen before in our life. And then you say, well, okay, what is the software that is going to define it? It's not just going to be neural networks. It's also going to be all of these mapping algorithms. There's this huge amount of sensor fusion. What's the infrastructure and HPC infrastructure you need to simulate an environment where you could never drive enough cars to do so? There was a report in the United States that said, in order to say that a car would be safe, it would have to drive 100 billion miles. That would take us tens, if not hundreds of years to physically do with the fleet of cars that are out driving around. So what do we have to do? We have to create a virtual environment for these cars to drive, because we don't want to have to capture in live a child running in front of a car, but the car has to understand how to deal with that. So simulation is a computer graphics problem, it's an accelerated computing problem, and it helps teach our neural networks how to be safer and safer and more robust. So I like to reflect on that, because what we've learned in the self-driving space has huge applicability in healthcare and what healthcare is going to mature into. So the rest of the presentation, I really want to talk about what are some of the interesting areas and maturity of these areas in healthcare. So some of it's going to be really great progress, some of it's going to be it's emerging, and some of it is kind of you're going to see some great stuff in 2 to 3 years, and hopefully that can inspire some great discussions. So the instruments of precision medicine are one of the things I like to think about. The instrument itself of the data that we're generating, and how could you even think about making that instrument more intelligent itself? If you think about a CT, I like to use MR because it's actually more complicated, an MRI machine, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of ways for you to set that machine up. That is introducing a ton of variability in the data that's probably unnecessary. So what are the ways that even at the acquisition point we can apply artificial intelligence for intelligent instruments? But then just keep thinking about how we are adding new instruments into essentially the sensor collection of the human life. 2017, cryo-electron microscopy won the Nobel Prize. I was visiting NTU, it was NTU guys, right? Okay, thank you. The Institute of Structural Biology, they have an instrument that can produce 3 terabytes a day of data. They have to figure out new computational paradigms to deal with the analysis of that data. And they also use things like motion correction at the point of acquisition, so they know these crazy expensive experiments are gonna produce really good data moving on. But I think this goes to show you that the complexity and variety of the data that is going to be our journey towards precision medicine is like no other industry. Biology doesn't have an equation that governs it. It's creating the biggest data we've ever seen. So I believe that healthcare is probably going to be our largest consumer of accelerated high-performance computing of most all industries. And we'll keep talking about examples of how that happens. Again, healthcare data is huge. Well, how huge is it? I just talked to you about that 3 terabytes. This professor told me that by the Q3 of this year, it's gonna be 8 terabytes per instrument. These instruments are flying off the shelves. The camera detectors that serve them, they can't make them fast enough. And so therefore, we are creating massive amounts of data. The NIH in the United States calls it the resolution revolution. And so these are new instruments that are bringing new information about proteins. We're able to now understand the structure of proteins we previously were not capable of. Let's think about genomics. This is a really cool company. Hopefully you guys have heard of Oxford Nanopore. Nanopore is this third generation of sequencing. They have literally, it's smaller than this. They have a flow cell that you can hold in your hand, and that device there has an NVIDIA SoC in it, and it's just a little bit thicker than a telephone. It doesn't need internet connection, and it does a sequencing analysis, and it's about $5,000. You're able to take it into the field, test water, test crops for disease. They're getting more and more accurate that they're actually gonna do human genome sequencing, and they are as well, democratizing this technology. And it is a known fact, by about 2025, the genomics data is gonna supersede all of Twitter, all of YouTube, all of astronomy. And so we know we have some interesting computing problems ahead of us. And then all of the data that's now becoming available in the hospitals. If you think about it, United States is pretty well established. We've been digitizing health records and imaging for about 20 years. So our hospitals are sitting on petabytes, tens of petabytes of data. Much of it we call dark data and completely unused. So how can we light that up and bring more information into the healthcare system and the provider network especially? Here's a trend. I love to look at this. It actually surprised the heck out of me when I did this chart. So if you look at deep learning, that's a great slope, obviously logarithmic scale here. Look at imaging and genomics, kind of totally head-to-head here on what's happening. And I'm gonna show you that we are doing really well in imaging. We're making tremendous progress. It's making it into the clinics today. Genomics, I think we're just at the beginning, but the publications show that this is something that is going to be a reality not too far from now. And that third category I'll talk to you about is drug discovery. Drug discovery is very problematic. It's 6 to 7 years, it's $1 billion, if not more, and it totally affects what happens in the second process, which is clinical trials, manufacturing, and commercialization. The whole journey taking 15 years and costing $2.5 billion. Pharma industry is in dire straits. We have to think about how we do this stuff in silico and less experimentation. I don't say we eliminate experimentation, I don't believe in that, but we can certainly augment experimentation with a lot more in silico. So I'm really, really encouraged by this. If you see the tail end of this drug discovery, they're having the same curve as what's going on in the general deep learning population. So let's talk about when I think about the opportunities here along the spectrum, there's 3 critical points where we're gonna have to apply AI in lots of different ways. I already kind of alluded to the instruments. Being able to create the most pristine data at the point of acquisition, to me, is a must. It will literally govern the success for the rest of the pipeline. If you have crappy data in, you will have crap coming out. So how do we make this the best? And plus, these instruments are very expensive to own and run. So there's a lot of activity at the analysis, at the acquisition point, excuse me. And so then we talk about the huge amount of data that they're generating. How do you do analysis? And I'm thinking analysis in a very sort of narrow way. So for MRI, it could be brain scans analysis, or it could be genomic sequencing, could be high content screening, which you see down here. This and these analysis have to become more and more efficient and more intelligent so we can feed what is the ultimate goal, precision medicine. Precision medicine will only be achieved with the integration of this data. You need to know about the genetic makeup of the human. You need to know what's going on in their everyday life and everything in between in order to have this realized dream of precision medicine. So I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about how that's manifesting. We have opportunities to create new intelligent instruments. We have opportunities to take even all the instruments that we have and just augment them with computers. It's just like your phone. They've created some data, but you connect it up to the cloud or a data center, and they can do pretty magical things. So I want to talk how last year was a super exciting year. I started working in radiology at NVIDIA, and this last year made me feel like we made some serious stuff happen. I mean, the iterative reconstruction is also an awesome achievement, as is beamforming and ultrasound. Don't get me wrong. But we've been working on AI in healthcare now for several years, and to see the commercial industry really bring it into clinical practice, hundreds of FDA-approved applications, commercially available applications from some of the largest healthcare vendors. Canon, which acquired Toshiba, makes one of the most sophisticated CT scanners in the market. Instead of iterative reconstruction, they have now created an AI reconstruction algorithm. And so they're able to, again, reduce that dosage, so they maintain that, and they're able to reconstruct literally in real time, 40 frames per second. Pretty, pretty fantastic achievement at a very, very high image quality. Their product is called ACE. GE Healthcare, and so that's kind of following that trajectory of acquisition to analysis to integration. Here, GE Healthcare created a new platform called Edison. Edison will host all of their AI infrastructure going forward, but one of the cool applications they had, and you don't think about radiology in an efficiency way. You might think like, oh, I created a lung nodule detector and it performs better than the radiologist. That was the early day applications, but there's so much opportunity along the way. This is a case in point. How can I look at a scan and detect that there's a brain hemorrhage, blood on the brain, and just put that patient to the top of the work list because it's a really critical condition? You wait any longer, you suffer brain damage, stroke, et cetera, et cetera. And it not only costs the patient potentially their life, it costs the health system a massive amount of money as well. Huge efficiencies that we can have here. And so if we think about the practice of radiology changing versus just being able to do a computer vision action better than a human, I think that's where we're really gonna see value in this system. Here's another interesting with Siemens Healthcare. So they are actually taking, and they look at the entire anatomy in, like, say, an abdominal CT, and they will measure it. They will quantify the organs, and they will compare it against what is recommended or what is said to be healthy versus abnormal. And they will automatically generate a report. Huge efficiencies here. So I'm just giving you a flavor of these are ready to go applications that were announced at the Radiology Society of North America. So for me, the age of AI in radiology is absolutely here. And there's, if you think back to that practice of radiology from the point of acquisition, excuse me, I didn't mean to do that, to the point of interpretation and report, there's thousands of algorithms that will execute. And so in that spirit, one of the platforms NVIDIA created is called NVIDIA Clara. It's after the woman Clara Barton. She developed the American Red Cross, which is a platform that helps people. That's kind of what we're trying to do here. So this is an open compute platform, and it's a hardware and software solution alike. But think of it as a software development kit that takes all of the technologies that we talked about, from accelerated computing to artificial intelligence and to visualization, and package it up in an infrastructure way that it makes it accessible to all of these new algorithms that want to be put into place. So if it's an intelligent instrument, we have a platform to support it. And then if you want to go back and think about upgrading the entire install base, this platform will also take care of that. It uses modern infrastructure like containerization and Kubernetes, something that the radiology departments have no idea what that is. They put some compute in the scanner, they put a little bit more in the tech workstation, they put some over here in the diagnostic workstation, and they're not upgradable today. Well, that's a tragedy because we've made a huge amount of progress in applications of all kinds for radiology over the last 5-10 years that everybody should be able to take advantage of. And it's just a couple GPUs that need to be accessed and some applications. So this is available, and we are actively developing it. Genomics is going mainstream. So I don't know about you guys, but yep, I spit into a cup and I have 23andMe. We have hospitals in the U.S. that it is a standard part of clinical care. It is absolutely going mainstream, and for many reasons. We are reducing the cost of actually doing the sequencing. You can see this trajectory. This is also a plot that came out of NIH. The blue line is what, you know, Moore's Law looks like. Illumina kind of thought the yellow line was about going to be our data problem. The red line is what's actually happening. So how are we going to deal with all that? And we're working with companies. This is Parabricks. They're actually doing a lot of POCs in Asia. They've accelerated the bioinformatics pipeline. They do that through CUDA, and now they're even doing it with Deep Variant, which is one of the new variant callers that Google generated, and optimizing that pipeline that otherwise is quite expensive to run in the cloud. We can now do it in about 40 times faster. This is what I'm really pretty excited about. If you think about all this data that we're generating, and we want to start to get towards precision medicine, and we want to start understanding populations better, we want to do population studies. But it's going to take a massive amount of compute. So this year, NVIDIA built the world's fastest supercomputer at the Oak Ridge National Lab. It's called Summit. The fastest scientific computation on record is this one called Comet. And what it does is population genomics, where it looks for variants and networks of variants that contribute to a certain disease state. They're actually actively studying the opioid crisis in the United States. So what are the genetic variations or network of those that is causing this population of people to get that addiction and these others not to? They'll also be addressing neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's. This is a 2.31 exa-op calculation, the fastest in scientific history. And this, to me, while it can take 1 hour on 27,000 GPUs versus it would take literally 30 years on a normal desktop. I know it's an unfair comparison, but it's pretty awesome. And it's a combination of accelerated computing and AI. It's not just one thing. It's both of those things. And so what I know is what's achievable on the fastest supercomputer today will be achievable to the rest of us in just a couple short years. And so we are going to be able to do population scale application development very soon. Pharma is embracing AI, finally. I shouldn't say that. They've been using AI for some things, but there's just been kind of a massive explosion in the applications that are being used, as well as kind of the people in the ecosystem. So if you think about it, there are 10,000 papers published by PubMed every single day. So by the end of my talk, that'll be like, what, 20 or 30? How could anyone read through that literature? So there's a company called Benevolent AI in the UK. They use NLP and deep learning so that they can take a lot of that information and gather something. They found two novel targets out of studying the literature and immediately signed deals with the pharma companies. You have in genomics, to be able to do better base calling, variant calling, improve the performance of all of this bioinformatics analysis, and even push it towards looking at how can we understand what oncology we could potentially produce. So deep genomics is another one, and Parabricks, who are just accelerating that process. Understanding proteins, so these cryo-electron microscopes creating all of this data, how can you use it to automatically segment or particle pick so that you're looking at great protein structures. In molecules, compound prediction, or even there's a company called InSilico who uses generative adversarial networks to literally invent compounds. They've invented over 5,000 compounds. Again, they have a deal with every single pharma company. We look at cells. How do we look at digital pathology or high content screening? These are vision problems, so we're back into the vision domain. But to me, if we can shorten that process, and again, do more in silico versus in pure experimentation, we can reduce the cost, and as we understand our populations better, we're gonna have to more rapidly be able to discover and create drugs. So this is awesome. This is what I was referring to, the machine learning platform, so not everything is imaging. Absolutely, there's a lot of other data. We've been working with the open source community for machine learning applications, and in October of last year, we announced the release of what's called RAPIDS. So Coup Data Frames, Coup Machine Learning Library, and Coup Graph, all interfacing with the open source ecosystem as you would want it in a data science platform. And what was really cool about that is we announced it in October, and by November, when we went to GTC China, the largest, probably three most important Chinese companies in their domain had adopted it with great success. So Ping An is the largest health insurance company. Again, now they were able to speed up by 80 times their population disease prediction. BGI, 17 times on personalized immunotherapy for cancer. iCarbonX, not sure if you're familiar with these guys, really fantastic ambition and mission. They study everything about the digital footprint of the human, microbiome being one of theirs. In a microbiome, you could have 500,000 features that you want to understand about any one person, and that's a huge data science problem. And they'll use it for important things, like if you have type 2 diabetes and I understand what's going on in your gut, what might I actually prescribe or recommend or coach you to do in your diet to help you deal with this chronic disease. This is also another one that I love. It kind of gets to the point of integration, and this is where we're just getting started. Geisinger is one of the earliest, I'm kind of blocking their name here. They're a really fantastic hospital. They're actually an integrated delivery network in the United States, which means they're a provider system as well as an insurance system. They adopted electronic health records more than 20 years ago. So they have well over 20 years of longitudinal electronic health data. Their CEO, who also just went to join Google, decided 2 years ago that genomics was going to be standard of clinical care. And of course, they sit on buckets of imaging. And so the team there is really thinking about how can I incorporate imaging, health records, and genomics to know a lot more about what's going on in my population. And they have some really great results so far, and we're working with them on, you know, we talked about optimized deployment of care teams. I mean, everything from operational to how can we prevent someone from having an adverse event while they're in the hospital care. So this to me is an indicator, early indicator of what's truly about to come. And I hope that I've showed that the entire ecosystem is getting involved in this process. You have Ping An, who's an insurance company. You have Geisinger, who is a hospital. You have the iCarbonX and all the startups of the world. You have the Mercks and the Pfizers and the drug companies. No one company, no one part of the healthcare system is not going to be largely affected by this new computing paradigm, which is artificial intelligence. And we're just excited to be able to be on the journey with the ecosystem. NVIDIA ourselves, we don't know that much about biology, and we don't pretend to. What we know is how to make AI work. And so if we can work with the ecosystem and understand the problems, then we can help build the infrastructure that makes this all go around. So we hope that you think about computers and our computing platform that we build as the instrument to really make this journey of precision medicine possible. And so I think that about ends it. Just recapping is how we think about the problem. So I'll end it there so Steve and I can have a talk. Thank you.
Okay, cool. Thank you, Kimberly. And I hope that you found that helpful and illuminating. So what I'm going to do is keep my promise and see if anybody wants to jump in early. Let me try and make sure that I've got this open. Okay, so please jump in on Slido. What I'm going to do, Kimberly, is ask sort of a generic question of the audience, and then let's see where this goes. So these are always the curious and interesting informal straw poll surveys. So when I think about the future of healthcare, I already exposed my bias. I'm a believer that this thing that we broadly call artificial intelligence is both important and inevitable. But I'm generally a tech optimist, and I want to trust. So I'm going to ask the question, raise your hand if you, quote, trust that AI will become an important part of your healthcare future, including the idea that you will work with the technology in a way that is trustful. I will trust its diagnosis. I will trust its recommendations. I'm not saying that we don't have doctors in the middle, but that a lot of the engine and a lot of the brain, if you will, behind the curtain will increasingly be this idea of AI. So trust is something that you're a part of. What do you think that looks like, Kimberly? Is that sort of half? I mean, I'm trying to get a sense of...
It's
75-ish
percent.
Okay, his hands sort of generally float up and down. So this idea of trust leads to the bigger question of adoption, because sometimes it's the technology, and sometimes it's just the societal comfort with using technology, and self-driving vehicles would be an example, and so on. You meet a lot of people all around the world. Do you have a sense of whether society is ready to adopt and embrace an AI-powered healthcare environment, or do we still always need to sit with Dr. So-and-so face-to-face? Is there always a human dimension?
Yeah, part of this is going to be my personal opinion and a little bit about what I've experienced, but many of us experience medical errors. I have a huge scar on my foot because I experienced a medical error. I believe that if we can express how we could avoid medical error, how AI can be a second opinion instead of the first, then trust will become more and more easy to do. And so that's one aspect of it. The doctors, I think all of us are going to want a doctor in the middle. I don't know what I would do, and I think this was part of the problem with 23andMe back in the day, is it was giving you too much information about yourself, and you didn't know how to process it. I was talking with somebody who was looking at sepsis. Sepsis, being able to, oh, there you are. And we're discussing about, okay, sepsis, what was it? It kills 20% of the people in hospitals. And so if we can predict it now, okay, the tech is there. Mm-hmm. But how do we intervene in that? Right, so the intervention and the change management that has to happen in the system, it's going to take time. But to me, I would trust that algorithm. And then there's kind of some areas where people don't have the choice to trust it or not. I just spent a week in China. I went to the largest pulmonary hospital in the world. As you know, lung cancer there is pretty much an epidemic. And he's a world-renowned radiologist. He has over 30 million followers, okay, on the social media networks that are used in China, WeChat, I suppose, and otherwise. He believes that about 30 cases a day is the maximum that the eyes of a radiologist can really process before they reach fatigue. He has well over 100. So what happens at those 70 other cases? How good of a job could he do? He doesn't have kind of luxury of necessarily trust. But he uses AI as a companion to help him through that massive amount of workload. So, you know, you could spin this question in so many different ways, skin the cat of what trust is and how you'd interpret it. But in terms of medical error, in terms of not having a choice, and then in terms of the tech being there, but how do you create that change management and process, these are all critical things we have to work on as a community. Like, mm-hmm. No one person can make it happen.
Mm-hmm. When you think about the different uses, and I'll again refer generally to AI in the sort of broadest context, so please forgive me in advance, I'm not trying to decompose it into sort of constituent parts, but this idea of an artificially intelligent system, how do we want to think about potential prejudice? Because the idea that people always want to discuss, there's a great aspect, there's a scary aspect, whether you think of it in military or other, but when you think about bias, is there a real risk, based on your perspective, of where people would be relying upon systems that would say, I've done the math, this particular person with this particular case, let's not progress. Disintermediating the human aspect that we all trust and rely upon. Is there a quote, scary aspect of AI in health, or do we just need to sort of carry on knowing that things will be amazing?
I think wherever AI is being applied, we have to take great care of in bias, in understanding data strategies, in understanding the deployment of it. It's unquestionable that you have to think about those things. Can we address some of the potential bias in the systems? Yes, you can do that through technology. By allowing more data to be introduced into the systems, you can help relieve some bias. Bias in terms of how it's used, again, this is going to come down to policy. Computer-aided diagnosis is not a new thing, but I wouldn't largely say it was successful for a lot of reasons. And so we have to understand the problem deeply, and I would say, again, this is a policy thing, a practice thing, a trust thing. So great care has to be introduced. I drive a Tesla Model 3 at home, NVIDIA's chip inside. This thing is not, I let it drive me, but it's nowhere near prime time, okay? And so, yeah, it's put me in a few dangerous positions because I overtrusted it. And it has this weird bias where it drives literally right on the left-hand lane, and I don't understand that. So as a consumer or as a user of AI tech, we should always be questioning it and keep feeding that into the system so we can, use it for good.
Okay. Let me try and paraphrase briefly just a couple of the questions that are coming in. So forgive me if this is your question and I paraphrase, but with the cost of healthcare increasing, is there a risk that when we think about AI that it makes worse or makes better this idea of a digital divide, the haves and have-nots? So does AI-enabled health become the luxury of even smaller numbers of people and even more rich countries, or is it a democratizing influence bringing healthcare to people that today may not have something?
Yeah, I feel the latter. I believe it's democratizing. I use radiology because we're well ahead on this journey. If you think about it, an expert radiologist takes over 12 years to become an expert radiologist. But an AI plus a radiologist can be close to expert in just a couple years of training. What that says to me, if you look again back to China, thinking about it, in rural China, where you maybe have only one or two radiologists, and they're expert in nothing, they're more of a generalist, you can bring that expert lung nodule or lung cancer suite to that rural hospital, and now you're democratizing the care you can only get at that Shanghai pulmonary leadership hospital. So in my mind, we can really see that it will democratize the access of expert high-quality systems.
So let me pick up and continue on with the theme since you've mentioned China. You and I chatted a little bit before about this idea that China, some would argue that China has a big head start because it has a quote-unquote massive amount of data. And we had Dr. Li Kaifu arguing the case in favor of lots of data makes for great artificial intelligence. You mentioned a moment ago bad data means bad output. Mm-hmm. So in a data-constrained environment, but of the best quality, I think you used the word pristine, does it matter how much data as long as it's excellent quality and pristine, meaning there isn't a natural advantage to having a huge amount of data once you've passed an acceptable amount for training and testing? So does China have any logical advantage in this versus any other country, including Singapore?
I think there's a couple ways you can skin this question as well. Because of all those publications in deep learning, and because the deep learning and AI community is so open, there's a lot that we can leverage, okay? And there is also, for sure, a known fact that if you don't have good training data, you will have a crappy AI algorithm. NVIDIA tried to, when we were starting our self-driving car effort, we tried to use things like Mechanical Turk and otherwise, because it's just RGB data. Like, any person can tell if this is a car, a sign, a fire hydrant, whatever. It didn't work. We now employ over 2,000 labelers that run around the clock. We have triple QA systems in that data labeling service. And that's the only reason we've been able to make as much progress as we could make. So, size of the data, I'm sure there's other companies who have a lot more cars driving around, but they're nowhere near NVIDIA is. And I say that because we took such great care in our data strategy that it really makes a huge difference. Now, on the other side of it, what we're seeing in things like, again, back to radiology, we believe that transfer learning and doing adaptation in some way, shape, or form is going to be a very good idea and a way for you to get back to very good accuracy. So what I mean is, you might train a lung, I'll go back to just keeping it simple, a lung nodule detector at Massachusetts General Hospital, and you try to deploy it at Santa Clara Hospital, it's probably not going to work well. And the reason for that is, that hospital, MGH has two-year-old instruments. They have a protocol for which they set up their instruments, and they have a certain demographic. You introduce it to a completely different hospital, and all that variability in the data throws the algorithm off. But if you have a way to do a very simple annotation, so we've created an AI-assisted annotation tool connected to a transfer learning toolkit, now you can ask the radiologist, maybe they only have to do 20, 50 cases, and they do this local adaptation, and now you go back to the original accuracy that was the algorithm intended. So, you know, I think our thinking along this is going to be technologically driven, and I think it's going to be a thoughtful data strategy driven. And no, I don't think just the most amount of data wins.
So, not surprisingly, a lot of questions relating to this theme of data. And perhaps this is one of those, yeah, no kidding sort of questions for you, but compared to other industries, is the healthcare-related industry naturally the most conservative or concerned or protective of data, and therefore potentially the most challenging to try and tackle?
I think the financial services industry is pretty protective of data because it's so lucrative. And then, you know, there again are new ways of breaking through some of these challenges in healthcare, de-identification of healthcare, governments getting involved in creating open data sets, huge. GlaxoSmithKline is a very large pharmaceutical industry. They donated 2 million compounds, essentially, to a consortium that is literally addressing that early drug discovery process and trying to do it all in silico, AI-driven, et cetera. So I think everybody is a patient in the end, right? And it's critical to every single nation. And so there's a lot of people who can play a role here, from commercial companies to government institutions, and so on. So
I'm going to do another straw poll, partly because I'm always curious about this particular question too. It comes back to this idea of trust. So when you think about de-identification or anonymization, if you think about putting information into a medical use, as in, please can we have your data de-identified or anonymized for use in this environment, do you feel comfortable enough with that to put your data? So for those that would say, I'm willing to make my own personal medical information available as long as the person on the other side of the equation I reasonably trust to have that be anonymized, is that something that you feel good enough about? Because a lot of people say, yeah, I know they say that, but I'm sure somebody somehow somewhere could get back to identifying. So would you choose to do that in a medical environment if people were to ask you to help them with this idea of improving algorithms and improving research and so on? Put your medical information in with the confidence of making it anonymous. Yes, you would, or no, you wouldn't?
Yeah.
Yes, you would.
Woo! Okay. Thank you, guys.
This is one of those where people always like, but okay, it's good to see. Maybe this is being posed by my good friends that are here from NVIDIA, but What kind of NLP applications do you see in healthcare, especially with the huge computing power of NVIDIA? So.
Wow, NLP. I gave you that one example of searching literature. Other examples is you have these large payers who have just, you know, how many claims are going on. They use it for fraud detection. They use it for understanding what's going on in their whole subscriber. I think it's kind of unlimited here. You can think about there's a lot of call centers and how do you adapt those whole workflows to make that experience better. It's an area that we're actively developing, but it's an area that needs a lot of work, and it's difficult. It's a difficult challenge, especially with, you know, many different languages and many different applications. Where do you even start?
If you think about it, and I'll just jump in on a question, it's not here, but if I sort of think about NLP, deep learning, just for argument's sake, and vision or image detection, do you have a sense that there's a dimension of this aspect of artificial intelligence that's further ahead, as in we're it's more obviously making progress? If NLP is quote-unquote perhaps hard, there's lots of image detection, there's different use cases, and I know there's lots of examples with machine learning and deep learning, but do you have a sense that of AI, there's an area that's further behind, as in needs a lot more work to sort of catch up with other parts of the constituency, or all sort of horses running equally well in the race at the moment?
No, I think NLP is a super big challenge, as is natural language understanding. I mean, there's so many different ways to say things. There's so many different languages in which they're said. It's completely unstructured information, but there's a vast amount of value in that. So I would say that's where we need lots and lots more investment. I think vision is on its way in a lot of good ways.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to read the question that's here, and I'm not sure that I understand exactly myself, but I'll read it to you anyway, Kimberly. In drug discovery, there's bias if one uses existing data sets. How would AI circumvent this, especially when there is reliance on poor clinical disease models? So it's got some upvotes, but I'm not sure that I'm correctly articulating it, so I chose to read it as is. Does that resonate, or do you want me to ask some of the people that had the upvote if they want to phrase it in their own words in case it's not capturing what you intended?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I can make a good answer for that.
I struggled. So if you want to shout it out from the audience, or if it's on your heart and you want to...
I am not a drug discovery expert, so I don't think I'm going to make a good comment on that. The cell applications that, you know, for example, that we've been working on with some of these startups are largely to understand what's going on in these crazy experiments, crazy expensive, crazy large data experiments. So I'm not an expert enough to give you a good answer.
Okay, let me crack on, and I'm sure you've handled this question thousands of times, but I'll ask it nonetheless. Are there some sort of moonshots, to use that expression, when you think about AI and health? You know, I guess one example would be, let's cure all known types of cancer, but what are some of the big moonshots of AI applications in healthcare? What are the things that I guess would make you most sort of gee whiz when you think about the art of the possible?
Yeah, so there are a couple really, precision medicine is a moonshot, I suppose, but kind of going down a particular path of oncology, where, you know, if you can really think about looking at things at a nanoscale to all the way through to a population scale, I think these projects that are happening at the supercomputing centers and with the large corpuses of data that we're now generating in these government initiatives, being able to create usable applications and insights out of that, to me, is actually kind of a moonshot. And then each one of these industry industry constituents, whether you're a pharma company, you're an insurance company, you're a provider, how do they put that to use is something that, you know, we all have to be thinking about. So I think, you know, there are lots of genomics initiatives going on around the world. There are some really interesting activities going on in, pathology and in the UK around imaging. The moonshot, how could you not pick cancer? Yeah. Cancer, and then, where you see things like personalized immunotherapies. Immunotherapy has completely transformed cancer treatment in just such a short amount of time. But there's a huge amount of people who don't respond to it, and it's still super expensive. And so how do we really apply it to personalizing some of those critical breakthroughs that are, life and death to, unfortunately, the people who have these tragic diseases?
Whenever we talk about AI, inevitably we have to talk about what does it mean to men and women that have a particular role that may be affected. So let me just, one of the questions here, which I think is broadly worded helpfully, what does AI mean for the skill requirements of future healthcare professionals? And how do they need to be, to sort of use the expression, ready to fit into this new AI-enabled future?
Yeah, I have a little bit of experience in this. And the Radiology Society of North America is the largest conference of the year, happens in November every year in Chicago. I want to say 60,000 people turn up, about 20 to 30,000 of those are radiologists. 3 years ago, they hated AI, and they thought AI was going to take their job. So 2 years ago, NVIDIA brought our Deep Learning Institute to RSNA. It has an introduction to deep learning course. It has a little computer vision problem. It has even more advanced how to use generative adversarial networks to create synthetic data. We trained about, 800 2 years ago. We trained over 1,200 this year. They went from having 8 AI talks 3 years ago to 270 AI talks. Education is a huge part of this process. And once they understand the intent, because at first it was a bunch of tech companies that found some open source data and said, I can do something better than you can. Like, that wasn't super helpful. But when you put it in and you say, I can completely screen out, the 70% of normal cases that you have every day, and then I can point you to the most important areas of a 1,000 slice CT scan where I found an anomaly, the doctor said, holy crap, that just transformed my whole day, right? So that level of education and experience and understanding is critical, and now they see it as a me plus this new tool. It's just like having a clicker to advance my slides instead of having to go over and touch a button. So being able to realize it in that way is great. And so they should, my hope is nurses, technicians, radiologists, all clinicians find it to be a tool. But like electronic health records, it's completely necessary, but absolutely trashed the efficiency of our hospitals for the first 5 to 10 years, and it's still really hard to implement. So it's critical, but how do we make these systems integrated, useful, and not become a burden on them to use? That was the problem with computer-aided diagnosis for mammography years ago. They found too many false positives. And so the radiologists were spending more time dismissing the false positives than they were getting value out of finding, the actual problems. And so these are all the things that, as we design AI in and as these medical imaging companies design in, we have to be really thoughtful about that.
It's interesting because there was some information out recently about a different AI-based solution from another tech company, and the discussion about doctors was their perspective. If there was something they considered a wrong diagnosis, the doctor dismissed the AI as unhelpful and not a good use of their time. If it was consistent with the doctor's diagnosis, they said, I could have, that was pretty obvious, so there's really no value add. So it was sort of a lose-lose at the moment. Just thinking about this one, what's the regulatory aspects for AI? Is it something that the FDA and HSA and others have some awareness of, or are you finding that you've got to do a lot of education of the regulators as well as the users?
I would say both. Certainly FDA I'm most familiar with living in the United States, but CFDA alike, they're creating AI teams. They understand this is a technology that for 100% they have to figure it out and understand it. The regulatory environment today, in medical imaging at least, it's very much, they approve a static algorithm. So if you can prove equivalency or you've done a trial to say that it has some efficacy, and they will approve that algorithm, but that algorithm in that state only. That algorithm is not improving. So it's not learning from the radiologist that said that is wrong and it was actually this. And so we're making baby steps. That's good because, in my opinion, it's unethical not to put these AI systems into practice if they were that helpful. But there's got to be an evolution where you learn from the AI in practice, because we have fantastic doctors in the system, and they should be able to disagree with the system and actually improve it. And so the education we do is really thinking about, from an infrastructure perspective, how could you safely learn and adapt these algorithms such that they do improve over time? We are not there yet. I'd say we're probably 5 years away from being there. But I think that's a critical process that we want to get to. So how do you know everything about the data that created these algorithms, and how do you track all that for reproducibility, traceability of the algorithms? That's going to take time, but that's what we, why we get involved and why we work with them.
So I'm bringing this home because I know you've got other commitments this evening. So do you see AI applications in counseling, mental health? So I'm going to sort of invoke the additional clarification, the way that I would read that, you could have an image detection and say there is or there is not something that I see. How do you think about AI in what we would normally think of as a lot of empathetically important conversations? How can AI help in a mental health or something that is harder for us to define through perhaps an algorithm?
Yeah, to be honest, I don't spend a lot of time in this space, but I think the opportunity is awesome. If you think about how much time we spend on our phones, these phones are massive detectors of all kinds, of our voice. I spent another at a university where they can detect through a cough how sick you are. They can detect your urine and how well things are, just by listening to you pee, how well things are working. I mean, I know, right? It kind of surprised me, but the fact is you have a microphone. Everybody has a microphone. So using sound, using the picture, understanding if you're shaking, it has an accelerometer. There's so many opportunities here. So from a mental health perspective, where people might start to retract from society, but probably are still, entrenched in these mobile devices, why not?
And I think Facebook was just talking about this just the other day, this idea of trying to understand through the way people are making posts or what they're saying and how, and to try and give moments of intervention possibly. And some people might say, gosh, that sounds too observational, and I don't want people to do that, and it might be important to save lives also. I want to try and bring this home to respect time for two things. One is we always like to be able to chat at the end of these because there's a lot of people with shared objectives and interests. That's the very purpose of these, as well as to make sure that Kimberly gets to enjoy chili crab and black pepper crab. So what I'm going to do is just think this through. Last question for you. When you think about AI and the future of health, what could Singapore, and I know you haven't had as much time here as we hope you will in the future, but is there something that we can do as a relatively small place but committed to science and education? What would your advice be to us, either from a startup community, or an investors community, a corporates community, government community? Is there a takeaway or two based on your other interactions with leaders around the world that we could try and take to heart?
Well, I think it's just capitalize on what Singapore is fantastic at. Number one, you implement the highest technology that's available when it's available. You have a very strong government and society in which the data is in a safe place, but it's in a well-maintained place and is kind of in a single place. That's an advantage that a lot of other places don't have. And then, you know, why not create more and more of these, how do you call it, proof of concept? I mean, this is the testbed city. So here is the place where you can, and you have so much diversity in your data as well. So many advantages here, actually, and your understanding of technology and always being so energetic around it and kind of open, the openness to it. These are advantages that many other countries don't have. I mean, United States will struggle with that till for a long time. So how can you really think about putting some real cool test beds in place and going from, you know, genomics data all the way to wearable data and everything that's going on in society and put that to use in healthcare light, that why not?
Cool. Well, what I'd like to do is ask you to join me in thanking Kimberly Powell from NVIDIA, and let's hang around. Thank you, Kimberly. Oh, it's just a matter of hanging out and catching up with whoever you want to talk about whatever you want to, and thanks again for being a part of it tonight.
Dancing with this silhouette in the places that we've been. Ooh, trying to find you in the moon. Paris never feels the same when the streets are calling your name. Ooh, so I hide in crowded rooms. And I'll follow right down the river with you. Send me the sky to you, to you. Once upon a time, somewhere down the line we went and lost it. One break at a time we watched it fall. I'm broken here tonight and darling, no one else can fix me. Oh.